It's actually tea and crime time today because my throat is still sore from my allergies, but let's just pretend it's coffee. I wish it was.
She's like a sickness in my brain, a vision standing by the window pane. She ripples through the blinds and leaves me in a daze. It's in the way her body moves me, the way she grabs me and intoxicates, until the signals in my mind forget to operate. She put the pressure in your fragile skull. I take my pleasure from my alcohol. She never give you any time at all. She just comes and goes, you know. And I, she's got me living in a chemical oven.
She's like a sickness in my brain. Hello, everybody. Welcome back to my channel, and thank you for joining me for another Coffee and Crime Time. I wanted to spend today catching up with Lori Vallow and Chad Daybell, since there's some updates in the case and, you know, their grand jury trial. So go grab your cup of coffee or tea, in my case, and let's quickly talk about the sponsor of today's video before we dive in. Sponsor of today's video is Casetify.
I've talked about Casetify before, but I have an IRL story of how Casetify cases and screen protectors literally saved my life last week. Well, not my life, that's dramatic, but they certainly saved my phone, which has a good portion of my life on it. Casetify's cases are slim and protective, so you really get the best of both worlds, like Hannah Montana, but better, because you don't have to be Hannah Montana. Casetify's impact cases are engineered with a two-layer construction of Chi-Tech, and they're drop test approved for drops up to 6.6 feet for impact cases and 9.8 feet for the ultra impact cases. They also come in a ton of designs and with customizable options, which is really great because super protective cases are usually kind of boring looking or just plain ugly. But with Casetify's cases, you can let your mood and your personality shine and not worry about your phone breaking. Their impact and ultra impact cases are made with 50% recycled material and shipped in 100% compostable packaging printed with eco-friendly ink, which is really important because sometimes brands say they're eco-friendly, but they forget about the packaging. So when you have a Casetify case in your phone, you can feel good about your phone looking great. And since cell phones are notoriously more germy than toilet seats, Casetify uses an antimicrobial coating to keep your case germ-free, killing 99% of bacteria. These cases are protective, really protective. The other day, I was trying to pick up Bella. I ended up throwing my phone in the air. It landed face down on the floor. The glass screen protector was cracked, but it's the first time it's cracked since I put it on my phone last April, and I probably drop it at least 6 or 7 times a day. But once I replaced the screen protector, my phone was perfect. So not only are their cases great, but their glass screen protectors are amazing. And I've gotten the cutest cases from Casetify. I really do like the ones with the little girls on them drinking coffee and reading books. I know it's basic, but I love the vibe. I have this really nice red one that says Stephanie on it, and it shows my astrological sign, Aquarius. My yoga skeletons case is probably one of my favorites. I think they're super cute. I got it for Halloween, but I have been putting it on my phone outside of October, I have to admit. But without a doubt, the ones I get the most compliments on are the cases that I've customized. I customized both these cases with Harlowe, and this one keeps me busy all day long because I just turn it and watch the sand or whatever's inside there move around. It looks so cool. It keeps my ADD mind busy, and I think the green stuff inside even glows in the dark. I don't know if it's supposed to, but I definitely see it glowing at night when it's next to my bed. The impact and ultra impact cases are customizable in a range of fonts, colors, and designs. You can use personal photos, stickers, and characters. Casetify's slimmest and most protective case is only 13 millimeters thin, and there's a raised bezel for top to bottom protection. I really can't say enough good things. Casetify cases are my absolute favorites, my go-tos, and if you want to check them out for yourself, go to casetify.com/stephanieharlowe today to get 15% off. That's casetify.com/stephanieharlowe. There's an E on the end of Stephanie and Harlowe for 15% off. Thank you so much to Casetify for sponsoring this video, and let's dive right in.
Okay, if you are not familiar with the Chad Daybell and Lori Vallow saga that's been ongoing for literally, 2 years at this point, I have linked my playlist on the case in the description box. I think I have several videos on it, but I will give you a quick recap before we dive into the new developments. Don't worry, though, I'll try to make the recap interesting, and there is a lot to talk about once we start going through the new stuff, so hang in there with me. Okay, so in December of 2019, we started hearing news reports about two children who had been missing for quite some time, but whose mother had not reported them missing. These two children were 7-year-old JJ Vallow and his 16-year-old sister, Tylee Ryan. JJ's grandparents, Larry and Kay Woodcock, they called law enforcement and asked them to conduct a welfare check in November of 2019 because they hadn't seen or spoken to JJ in months. And on November 26th, local law enforcement in Rexburg, Idaho, conducted that welfare check at the home of JJ and Tylee's mother, Lori Vallow, who was living at 565 Pioneer Road. Lori said that JJ was with a friend of hers, and this friend lived in Arizona. This was a statement that police quickly found to be a lie. Now, at this point, Lori Vallow was already married to Chad Daybell, who also claimed to have no knowledge about where his new wife's children were. When he did claim to have knowledge about them, he just kind of went along with whatever Lori was saying. So who are Chad Daybell and Lori Vallow, and how did they come to be at the center of this absolutely insane case? Chad Daybell was a Mormon novelist who's written several books for his LDS audience where many of the characters were, according to him, based on his own family members. And these books also had strong apocalyptic and futuristic themes. Chad also worked as a gravedigger for a time, and he claims to have had multiple near-death experiences that have allowed him to live with one foot in the spirit world. Chad Daybell met his first wife, Tammy, while they were both attending Brigham Young University, and they got married in March of 1990. They lived together in Springville, Utah, where they founded Spring Creek Book Company. This was a vehicle used to publish many of Chad's novels. The couple had 5 children together and eventually moved to Salem, Idaho, where Tammy worked as a librarian. As far as we can tell, Chad and Tammy Daybell were widely liked and respected by their community, and they seemed to be a very happy couple and have a very happy family. Lori Vallow had been an active member of the LDS Church since the time she was a little girl, and she raised all of her children in this same faith. In her lifetime, Lori would marry 5 different men by the time she was 46. Her first marriage was to her high school sweetheart, Nelson Yanez, in 1992. They had no children at the time of their divorce. In 1995, Lori married William Lagoa, and together the couple had 1 child, Lori's oldest son, Colby. They divorced a year later, and in 2001, Lori married her 3rd husband, Joseph Ryan, who she would go on to have a daughter with named Tylee Ryan. They divorced in 2004, and 2 years later, in 2006, Lori married her 4th husband, Charles Vallow, who had 2 children from a prior marriage. In 2014, Lori and Charles adopted JJ, the biological grandson of Charles's sister, Kay Woodcock, and JJ was just 2 years old at this time. Kay Woodcock said that JJ was level 2 on the autism spectrum, but she also said that early intervention had allowed him to flourish beyond expectations. In 2014, the family moved to the island of Kauai, where Lori and Charles operated a small business. They moved back to Arizona, I believe, in June of 2018. It may have been sooner, though. Reports sometimes say 2017, sometimes they say 2018. Does it really matter? No. Lori was known to be a great mother who put her children before everything, and her marriage to Charles Vallow seemed to be going very well. But then, in 2018, something changed, and Lori Vallow went off the deep end. And this change in her personality aligned with a new person she had met, doomsday author Chad Daybell. According to the East Idaho News, Lori met Chad Daybell in 2018 when he was teaching an evening class at the LDS church that she attended. The two reportedly became close, speaking daily from the time of their first meeting and even traveling together to a conference in St. George where Chad was speaking about his books. So basically, Lori was like a Chad Daybell groupie. That's how she started off. That's my opinion. Don't come for me. In April of 2018, Lori's third husband and Tylee's father, Joseph Ryan, died from what has been called a heart attack. And we'll never know if it was actually a heart attack or not because he was cremated, so we can't tell. On October 30th, 2018, Chad Daybell sent Lori an email rating her family members, including her ex-husbands and her children, as dark or light spirits because he believed that when people die, they are reborn, and he's able to look at a person and judge whether they have a dark or light spirit because of his connection to the other side. It's just one foot on the other side, but it's enough. Joseph Ryan, Tylee's father, who had passed that same year, was rated by Chad as a dark spirit. It's believed by law enforcement that this same month, just 5 days before the email was sent with the dark and light spirit ratings, Lori and Chad began discussing their religious beliefs and how these beliefs could be used to justify killing Chad's wife, Tammy, and Lori's two children, Tylee and JJ. In January of 2019, Lori and Chad appeared together on the Preparing Up People's podcast. I think it was like called Time to Warrior Up or something. And they would go on to make appearances on this podcast several times, with many of their conversations centering around the end times. On January 31st, 2019, Gilbert, Arizona police responded to the home of Charles and Lori Vallow, and comments from Charles were caught on body cam footage. Charles said that Lori had been exhibiting a pattern of escalating and bizarre behavior. She thought that he was a demon named Nick Snyder, and she had threatened to kill him. He told police that he had just arrived back from a business trip to find Lori had moved his vehicle from the airport parking lot where he'd left it when he boarded the plane to go on this business trip, and then she had taken $35,000 out of their joint bank account. Charles said that Lori was clearly losing touch with reality. She believed that she had special priesthood powers and that the world was going to be ending later that year. On the body cam footage, you can hear Charles pleading with Lori to go to the hospital and get some mental help. And you can hear him pleading with the police to have her mentally evaluated, which they did. And then they said she was fine. She was fine. Can you imagine the words Lori Vallow and the word fine together in the same sentence? I can't. Charles said he was worried about JJ and Tylee since Lori had recently made statements that she didn't care about what happened to them. In February of 2019, Charles Vallow filed for divorce, citing irreconcilable differences. Lori viewed herself as a god, preparing for the second coming of Christ, and she had told him that she would kill him if he got in her way. During divorce proceedings, Lori disappeared to Hawaii for 2 months, leaving her children with family members. And the following summer, Lori's niece, Melanie Boudreau, filed for divorce from her husband, Brandon, who was shocked because they got kids together, they got a great life, he thought their marriage was great, and it seemed to come out of nowhere. So Brandon told the media that he believed Melanie had aligned herself with the same off-the-wall beliefs that her aunt Lori had been spouting, and they were both part of a cult, which is so funny that he says cult because it's exactly what it was. But every time Melanie Boudreau got up on camera, she's like, this isn't a cult. This isn't a cult. This is just people who have similar beliefs meeting together, secretly planning to kill people and steal their insurance money. She didn't actually say that. It was just me ad-libbing what I think she would have said. Sometimes you can't tell the difference between what they actually said and what I'm just making fun of them for saying. A month later, in July of 2019, Lori's brother, Alex Cox, shot and killed her husband, Charles Vallow. And Alex claimed it was self-defense because Charles had hit him with a baseball bat, even though he didn't have, like, any injuries that would be consistent with a baseball bat. The following month, Lori, JJ, Tylee, Melanie Boudreau, and Alex had all picked up and moved to Rexburg, Idaho, which was super close by to where Chad Daybell lived with his then-alive wife, Tammy. The last time Tylee Ryan was ever seen was during a September 8th trip to Yellowstone National Park with her mother, her uncle Alex, and her little brother, JJ. This same day, Chad Daybell and his wife, Tammy, increased Tammy's life insurance to the maximum amount, which I believe is somewhere between $450,000 and $485,000. But I forget the exact number, but it was up there. All right, it was up there. JJ had been enrolled into school in Rexburg on September 3rd, but Lori took him out of school 3 weeks later, claiming she was going to be homeschooling him. And then nobody ever saw him again. On October 1st, Lori Vallow rented a 10x10 storage unit from the Self Storage Plus in Rexburg, and she has since been seen by surveillance videos visiting this unit 9 times in September, along with her brother Alex Cox a few times, as well as Chad Daybell a few times. On October 2nd, Melanie's husband was shot at by someone driving a Jeep that was registered to Charles Vallow, who was no longer alive at that time. Alex Cox. And the same day, Lori bought a wedding ring on Amazon. On October 9th, Tammy Daybell called the police and said she'd been approached by a masked man while she was unloading groceries from her car in the driveway of her home. And this masked man had tried to shoot her, but nothing came out, so she thought it was a BB gun. 10 days later, Chad Daybell called the police and claimed his wife, Tammy, who was fairly young and completely healthy, had suddenly and mysteriously passed away in her sleep. Tammy Daybell died on October 19th, and by November 5th, Chad Daybell and Lori Vallow were in Hawaii getting married on a beach, just laughing and smiling at each other, just super happy that both of their spouses were dead. While in Hawaii, Chad and Lori told people they had no children, and there are also reports that Lori told someone she'd had a daughter, but that daughter, who was named Tylee, had passed away years before. That brings us to the welfare check on JJ that his grandparents had requested when Lori told the police that JJ was with her friend Melanie Gibb, who lived in Arizona. But then the police called Melanie Gibb, and they were like, where's JJ at? And she was like, JJ's not here. He's never been here. And, by the way, bonus, Chad and Lori asked me to lie and say he was, in case anybody ever called asking about him. On December 1st, Chad and Lori, now happily married and keeping busy, you know, preparing for the end of the world, they got on a plane and flew to Hawaii. Neither JJ nor Tylee were with them. This started a chain of events that began with the deaths of Tammy Daybell and Charles Vallow, and people asking questions as to whether these deaths were really what they seemed to be, especially as more and more came out about the belief system, the bananas belief system of Lori and Chad, and as reports came in from people who had heard Lori call her children demons. Tammy Daybell's body was exhumed on December 11th, and the very next day, Alex Cox, who had also recently gotten married to a woman that he barely knew, a woman who was a follower of Chad and Lori's, he mysteriously died in Gilbert, Arizona. A later autopsy would give his cause of death as being due to a blood clot, but everyone felt the timing was really suspicious because Alex had died the day after Tammy's body was exhumed. And remember, someone approached Tammy with a gun in her driveway and tried to shoot her, Alex Cox, and she was like, what's happening here? I think it was a BB gun. And then 10 days later, she's dead. And now her body's being exhumed. And then the next day, he's suddenly dead. So it all seemed real sketchy. Chad and Lori were named persons of interest in the disappearance of Lori's children, and it was stated that they may also be connected to the death of Tammy Daybell. On January 3rd, 2020, police and the FBI conducted a search of Chad Daybell's home in Salem, and they recovered 43 items, including computers, cell phones, journals, documents, and medications. Larry and Kay Woodcock flew to Idaho and began offering a $20,000 reward for any information about where JJ and Tylee might be. On January 25th, Lori was served with a notice saying she had to reveal the whereabouts of her children within 5 days. But she, Chad, Melanie, and several other family members, such as Lori's mother and sister, they kept telling us that the kids were in a safe place. Lori was a great mother, and Lori was keeping the kids hidden for their own protection, alluding to the possibility that the Woodcocks had been threatening Lori. All the while, Chad and Lori were sunning themselves on a beach in Hawaii and sipping tropical drinks while the entire world looked for JJ and Tylee. And it seemed like they were the only people who didn't care where JJ and Tylee were. Law enforcement in Kauai seized their rental car and searched their rented townhome in Princeville, Hawaii. And then the 5 days that Lori was given to reveal the whereabouts of her children, those 5 days came and went. And on February 20th, Lori was arrested in Hawaii and charged with 2 felony counts of desertion and non-support of dependent children. She was extradited back to Rexburg on March 5th, and the Daybell's Hawaiian vacation came to a screeching halt. On June 9th at about 7 a.m., the Rexburg Police Department, FBI, and Fremont County Sheriff's Office descended on the home of Chad Daybell, and they had those digger machines with them, which I think they're called backhoes, but digger machine sounds really cooler, and they were going to dig with these digging machines. And while they were digging on Chad Daybell's property, they found the remains of 2 children, JJ and Tylee. At 11:30 a.m. that same day, Chad Daybell was arrested about a mile away from his home. I think he was trying to flee, but that's just my opinion. And he was charged with two counts of concealment, distribution, or alteration of evidence. And just this past week, on May 24th, 2021, a grand jury indicted Chad and Lori Daybell on charges of first-degree murder and conspiracy to commit murder. And on May 25th, the indictment containing additional information was released to the public, and that's what we're going to quickly go over now. So this indictment says the defendants, Chad Guy Daybell, Lori Noreen Vallow, and Alex Cox, and other co-conspirators, both known and unknown, on or between the dates of October 26th, 2018, and continuing until January 15th, 2020, did willfully and knowingly combine, conspire, confederate, and agree to commit murder in the first degree of Tylee Ryan, J.J. Vallow, and Tammy Daybell. The affidavit gave us what's called overt acts, which means acts that can be clearly proved by evidence and from which criminal intent can be inferred. We have overt acts for Tylee, for Tammy, and for JJ. One of the overt acts for Tylee is that on August 16th, 2019, Lori changed the deposit of Social Security benefits that were going into Tylee's JP Morgan Chase bank account so that the money would now go directly into Lori's own personal bank account. God told her to do that, okay? This is not her fault. It also says that on September 8th, 2019, Chad Daybell Googled SSW wind and visited a site entitled What's the Definition of SSW Wind Direction? And it looks like this site, from what I can tell because I did my own searches, it was actually Quora. And if you don't know what Quora is, it's like a website you can ask questions and then other people answer them. But SSW wind is just a reference to wind direction. The theory about why he would be looking this up can be explained by looking at the date he Googled it, right? September 8th, the same day Lori and Alex brought JJ and Tylee to Yellowstone National Park, the last day that Tylee was seen alive. Law enforcement believes that Tylee was killed the next day before being burned and buried on Chad's property, and the fact that he was looking up wind directions the day before she died, it can show premeditation. Chad Daybell lived on a property where he did have neighbors, but according to Reddit user, a Starship Trooper, there is an uninhabited tract of land next to his property, and this tract of land is presumably downwind of an SSW wind. It's believed that what the lawyers will be trying to prove is that Chad, on September 8th, looked up the weather for the next day, saw there was going to be an SSW wind, and not knowing what that meant, he looked it up, because you can never be too careful when you're planning to murder a teenage girl. I mean, we all know this. So even though the term SSW wind is pretty, you know, self-explanatory, south-southwest wind, Chad Daybell wanted to cover his bases. He wanted to make sure he knew everything about that damn SSW wind. We also know that Alex Cox was at Chad Daybell's house on September 9th, the day that law enforcement believes Tylee was murdered. We know that he was there because his cell phone records put him there in the general vicinity where Tylee's body would later be recovered. We know that Chad texted Tammy, his still alive wife, on September 9th and told her, you know, if you hear gunshots or if someone tells you they heard gunshots, you know, don't be alarmed because I was outside and I shot this big raccoon. What a dick. And we know that neighbors of Chad Daybell's reported seeing a big bonfire on his property on that date. It's very likely that Chad knew he was going to be starting a fire to burn a body, and he wanted to make sure that the wind direction wasn't blowing in a way that would alert people to that fact, because the smell of a bonfire is very different from that of burning flesh. And he knew that much. He may not have known what an SSW wind was, but he knew that people would smell burning flesh and be like, what's up? So it's pretty much understood that Tylee was dead on September 9th and that her mother continued to collect Social Security benefits in her name and didn't, you know, notify the Social Security Department to say that Tylee was dead because she was lying about Tylee being dead. And as far as JJ is concerned, the overt acts include the fact that Alex Cox took possession of JJ around September 23rd, 2019, and then JJ was never seen again after that. And Lori also continued to collect Social Security benefits for JJ while she lied to law enforcement about where he was. In regards to Tammy Daybell, the overt acts include text messages between Chad and Lori discussing death percentages for Tammy and JJ. And these messages happened on July 30th, 2019. Both Chad and Alex bought burner cell phones. Chad got his on September 18th of 2019, and Alex got his on October 9th of 2019, which by that time it's too late because you've already, you know, helped kill Tylee and bury her on Chad Daybell's property, which her cell phone showed, so probably should have gotten a burner phone a lot earlier. But I do think it's interesting that both Chad and Alex got these burner phones after they killed Tylee. I wonder what that conversation was like. I wonder what kind of prompted them to make that decision. There was also text messages between Chad and Lori where they discussed his wife Tammy being in limbo and being possessed by a spirit named Viola. The affidavit states that Alex attempted to shoot Tammy Daybell on October 9th, 2019, because this idiot made internet searches between October 8th and October 12th for Grendel drop, which is most likely in reference to the ballistics of a Grendel round for a rifle. He also searched for shooting through a Dodge Dakota. Alex also visited the Sportsman's Warehouse, which is a hunting store in Idaho Falls, on October 9th. So the same day that Tammy was shot at, but in the morning before the shooting, he went there. We don't know what he bought. He probably used cash because he's old school. You know, he's like, I can Google whatever I want and nobody will find out, but I can't use a credit card when I'm buying a murder weapon. You were halfway there, buddy. So close. And per Alex's cell phone records, he then drove to the Daybell residence where he attempted to shoot Tammy. He also visited a gun range in the months before October 9th, 2019, so he could brush up on his shooting. And something I found interesting is that the affidavit says that Alex was in a church parking lot. This church parking lot is about 2.5 miles away from where Tammy and Chad were living on the evening of October 18th, the night before Chad called the police and said his wife died in her sleep. So what was Alex doing just about 2 miles away from the house the night that Tammy died? Could it be that he helped Chad kill her? What? No, that's crazy. For all three of these victims, though, the same statement was repeated in the affidavit. Chad Guy Daybell and Lori Noreen Vallow did encourage and espouse religious beliefs for the purpose of justifying and or encouraging these homicides. Chad Daybell has been indicted by a grand jury for the murder of his wife Tammy Daybell, as well as 2 counts of insurance fraud related to life insurance policies that he had on her. Chad was also charged and indicted with conspiracy to commit murder and first-degree murder of JJ and Tylee, charges that he shares with Lori. Lori, besides those charges, was also indicted on the charge of grand theft related to Social Security survivor benefits that had been allocated to her for the care of Tylee and JJ. Madison County Prosecutor Rob Wood stated in a press release, quote, Fremont prosecutor Lindsay Blake and I believe all three homicides and the related financial crimes were committed as part of a continuing criminal scheme. Due to the ongoing safety restrictions imposed by the courts during the pandemic, we just recently were given permission to present information to the grand jury for their review. They deliberated and determined there's probable cause to believe that the Daybells willfully and knowingly conspired to commit several crimes that led to the death of 3 innocent people. End quote. The indictments do not reveal how any of the 3 victims were killed, and the results from Tammy Daybell's autopsy that happened after she was exhumed, they still have yet to be revealed. However, I have to believe that law enforcement found something substantial in this autopsy, perhaps something that corresponded with bottles of medicine that they removed from Chad Daybell's home, because the prosecutors were able to convince a grand jury that the evidence against Chad, Lori, and Alex Cox in the death of Tammy Daybell was more than enough to move forward, because the grand jury got a lot more evidence that we're not seeing in the affidavit, right? They got the evidence that we all want to know. So this was simply the grand jury's decision to indict. It was their job to decide if Lori and Chad should go to trial. They said yes, and then Lori and Chad were indicted. But an indictment is a far cry from someone being found guilty of a crime beyond a reasonable doubt, which, as we know, is the standard necessary to convict someone of a federal crime. So I'm not going to say that a grand jury indictment isn't a big deal, because it is, right? Especially in this case when we've all waited so long for some sort of official justice. But if Lori and Chad keep playing games, we may never get to see them stand trial in front of a jury of their peers and actually see the justice system hold them accountable for the disgusting and horrible things that they've done. And in my opinion, Lori Vallow, she's already started her game playing. I mean, she's done been playing games for a while, but she's still playing them, is what I mean to say. She never stops playing games, because this woman does not want to stand in a court and be judged by mere mortals. Only God can judge her. And he would never do such a thing to his most favored daughter. So apparently, Lori Vallow has been examined by a licensed clinical psychologist, and this person decided that Lori was mentally incompetent to stand trial. Judge Stephen Boyce said, quote, the evaluation was ordered after the defendant's fitness to proceed was drawn into question by counsel, end quote. So, if I'm reading this right, Lori's lawyers were like, listen, this woman's nuts. She's not competent to stand trial. And competency in the legal sense, it means that Lori is not capable of understanding the charges against her. She's not capable of following along with what's happening in the legal proceedings. And she's not able to assist her lawyers in her defense. And I'd like to know, who is this clinical psychologist? Who paid this person's rate for talking to Lori and coming up with this conclusion? And what drugs have they been taking? Because here's my thing. We all know that Lori is a banana split sundae with extra nuts. She's clearly not a quote unquote sane person. But the one thing I don't feel anyone could ever say about Lori Vallow is that she has no idea what the hell's going on. She certainly does. It is my belief that she certainly does. For the past several months, she's had no problem assisting her lawyers with her defense. She was able to plan and help execute all the murders of three innocent people that we know of. Two of them were not only children, but her own children that she raised. And I don't think it's going to be long before there's a fourth murder that she's charged with, since the Chandler, Arizona Police Department have just submitted a conspiracy to commit first-degree murder charge against Lori in regards to the shooting death of her ex-husband, Charles Vallow, because obviously, if Lori and Alex conspired with Chad to kill his wife, Tammy, it really only makes sense that they did the same thing to Charles. And everybody who's here is familiar with this case knows that Alex claiming he killed Charles in self-defense was bullshit, absolute nonsense. He definitely killed him in cold blood, and it was planned. Don't come for me, Alex, from the other side. And I believe that Lori and Alex did this so that Lori and Chad could not only be free to marry each other, but they would each be able to collect life insurance benefits from their recently deceased spouses. And that is what is at the root of all this, by the way, in my opinion. Money. Not religion. Not faith. Not God or the devil or the demon Nick Snyder. Money. If Chad and Lori believed that they were these great and powerful spiritual beings just straddling the line between the land of the living and the land of the dead, why the hell did they need so much money? If they thought the world was going to end in 2020, hello 2021, here we are, didn't happen, Lori, then why the hell did they need so much money? Like, the world's not gonna be around. I mean, right? Did the rules change? Can you now bring US currency into the spirit world and build yourself a nice little spirit mansion with a heated in-ground pool? You can miss me with that. Lori continued to cash the checks coming in for JJ and Tylee, even though she knew they were no longer alive, because she had a hand in their deaths, allegedly. But a grand jury agrees, so shove it, Lori. Is Lori Vallow 4 cents short of a nickel? Yes, absolutely. Does she have several large and important screws loose? Without a doubt. She obviously has only been rowing with one oar in that little boat she's been floating around in, a boat made of lies and narcissism and greed. But she knows exactly what's going on at all times, and she's made it very clear that she's not a novice to the game of manipulation. So remember when Lori was extradited to Rexburg from Hawaii on March 5th of 2020? Well, when she got there, she was booked into the Madison County Jail, and while there, she was sort of in isolation with one other female prisoner, a woman who has since gotten out of jail but wants to remain anonymous, so I'm just going to call her Betty because it's adorable. Jail records do confirm that Lori and Betty were in a segregated jail pod together between March 5th and March 8th. Betty said she knew who Lori was, everybody did, but she purposely didn't ask her about JJ and Tylee, who at that time were still considered just missing, because Betty didn't want to bring it up. She wanted to, like, build a relationship of trust with Lori and see if she could get her to, like, admit to anything. And Betty was like, you know, I was in jail for something I didn't do, so I was just going to give Lori the benefit of the doubt that maybe she also didn't do this. But Betty was also hoping that Lori would sort of, like, tell her one way or the other, or give her some information one way or the other. Betty says that from day one, Lori was always happy, cheerful, positive, and upbeat. Betty never saw her get upset. She never saw her look upset or act upset. Lori never cried or fell into periods of silence where she would just stare off into space, you know, like someone who's contemplating all the horrible things they've done. Lori told Betty that she was glad she was no longer in a Hawaii jail because the conditions there were very poor and there was roaches. Apparently, not enough roaches because you're still here, Lori. I wish they'd just eaten you right up. But even the roaches could probably sense that there was evil in you. And they were like, we don't want that bitter devil woman. They have standards, you know, higher standards than Chad Daybell, apparently. Okay, so the day after Lori gets back to Rexburg, she has her first court appearance in Madison County. And Lori was really looking forward to it, except for one thing. The one thing that was preventing her from, you know, really looking forward to it as much as she wanted to. It wasn't her guilt. It wasn't her inability to look at herself in a mirror or her fear of facing a judge and finally being, like, put on blast for what she'd done. It was the fact that her skin was dry. Her skin was dry. And she was concerned about how she would look in court. So Betty gave her some lotion, some makeup, and some deodorant that Betty had gotten from the prison commissary. And Betty said that on her way out to court, Lori stopped in front of her cell, Betty's cell, wearing bright pink lipstick, and she was like, "How do I look?" We all remember the bright pink lipstick, don't we? Then when Lori got back from her court appearance, she was still bubbly and cheerful, and she made Betty watch the news with her, saying, quote, "Here it comes. Here's my story. Turn it up. Let's see what they say about me now," end quote. Lori also said, quote, "We have the death of Kobe Bryant and COVID, but no, there's me. I'm the lead story. I'm more important than all that stuff," end quote. Betty said that Lori was constantly coming and going from her cell to meet with her lawyers, aka helping them prepare her defense, which she seems to have successfully and competently done. Competently, if you will. And how was she paying for her lawyer in 2020, by the way? With blood money? Right? Because just a few days ago, a judge declared her indigent because she claimed she couldn't afford a lawyer anymore. But how was she paying for one then? We've gone over Lori's financial situation in videos in the past. We know she didn't have any money until she started stealing it from others, obviously. So was she using the money that she took from Charles Vallow, Tylee Ryan, and JJ Vallow, three people that I 1,000,000% believe she had a big hand in killing, to pay for a lawyer who was going to attempt to save her from having to face justice for their murders? That's rank. That's like the lowest of the low. It seems like there should be a law against that or something. Anyways, I don't know how she paid for a lawyer. It could have been one of her many family members who still supported her even after they found out that those kids were dead. Who knows? Lori was always talking to Betty about getting bond. And one day, Betty asked Lori if, you know, she thought she was going to get bond. And Lori ran her finger up and down her body like this and said, "We'll see if all of this is worth $1,000,000. Betty said that when Lori wasn't meeting with her lawyers, she was reading scripture and praying. There are also many video calls with her son Colby and her husband Chad Daybell, who at this point had not been arrested yet, but it's coming, Chad boy, don't worry. Betty heard Lori tell Colby to read the book of Job so that he could understand what she was going through because she was being tested just like Job. So I don't know if Colby went ahead and read the book of Job, but I brushed up a little bit on the book of Job from my Catholic school education, and here is the main takeaway from Job's story. The theme is mainly, why do bad things happen to good people? So already I'm just disgusted that Lori thinks she's like Job. Why do bad things happen to good people? You think you're a good person, Lori? Do you think that? Job was a good, hardworking man, a God-fearing man, a moral man, but then his life fell apart. He lost his kids, he lost his job, he got really sick. And when he asked God, why, you know, why I've been so good, I've been so loyal to you, I do all the right things, I'm kind to people, why is this happening to me? There was no answer. Why was there no answer? Well, because apparently God and Satan, they were bored one day, and they were just hanging out somewhere, I don't know where, like, where do God and the devil meet? And they were like, who can we mess with? And God was like, what about Job? He's a really good person who doesn't deserve this at all. So I think he's perfect. And that was just Stephanie's interpretation. But in reality, it was more like a bet between God and the devil, where the devil was like, listen, Job's only a good person because he's rich in money and in life. And if he lost everything, he would turn away from you. And God was like, challenge accepted. Let me literally crush this man's spirit so I can illustrate to you how loyal these people are to me. That doesn't sound much better, does it? I'm not trying to be offensive to any religious people. It's just a joke. We're still allowed to laugh in 2021, right? I just have to check. Instead of turning away from God, Job doubled down on his faith because he believed that God will never give you more than you can handle. When Job asked God, why was this happening? God didn't answer because he needed Job to know that even if he couldn't hear or see God, God's always there. God is the master of the universe, the creator of the universe, therefore he knows all, and the people just need to trust him. And they need to not question why. They just need to believe in his plan and accept that sometimes life isn't fair and good people get screwed, but it's never for nothing because there's always some grand, larger plan behind it. So Lori feels like she's being tested by God, like Job, which means, once again, that she thinks she's a good person who has to go through all of these horrible things, not because she did something bad and she's paying for it, but because it's part of God's plan. Lori, from jail, told Colby on the phone, quote, "Colby, just listen to me. Everyone wants to know what's going on, but it's none of their business. God doesn't judge me, and they shouldn't judge me either. The prophet says to stay off social media, so don't go on there," end quote. Hold on. Let me consult with my Bible and figure out which prophet built his platform on urging people to stay off social media. I don't remember that one. I'm like getting so heated. I'm actually getting heated. Whoo, like hot. I'm so annoyed with Lori Vallow. I am so sick of her. So I did consult the internet, not my Bible. All I could find was the story of a psychic medium prophet named Leslie Weems, who apparently published a book in early 2021 called Wake Up, The End Is Coming. Really, really catchy title. The article that I found says, quote, "A woman with many spiritual gifts, such as discernment, knowing, seeing, hearing, and automatic writing, Weems only chooses to work in the white light and uses her empathic, psychic, medium gifts to help others heal." Okay, so far so good. I like this prophet. The article goes on to say, quote, "She has received detailed messages of what will happen in the future that have come to fruition, such as COVID-19 and its second wave, the Libya explosion, earthquakes in California, and the recent gathering of Donald Trump supporters at the Capitol." End quote. Apparently, Weems is getting these messages directly from God and the archangels, and they have also given her tips on how to survive the coming apocalypse so that she may be one of the very few who make it through, because she was told that only a small percentage of the world's population will survive. So Leslie Weems is sounding a little bit like nuttier to me now, you know, just a little bit. Because I don't like these doomsday prophecy people who have been around since the dawn of time. All right. They're annoying. They never predict things correctly. And then when the end of the world doesn't come when they said it was going to come, they've always got an excuse or a reason, you know, and it's all part of God's plan. But it never makes any sense and it never happens. And I'm not saying that like the world won't end someday, because obviously it will. But I am saying that I don't believe that these people are predicting it. I think, like Lori, they're a little off the rocker and also attention seeking. So apparently, I guess this woman, Leslie Weems, she's been telling people to get off social media, but I don't necessarily think that Leslie Weems was the prophet Lori was referring to. I wonder who the prophet was that she was referring to. Like, I just really want to know. I know I'm hung up on this, but Betty, Lori's jail pod mate, also said that Lori's calls with Chad were quote unquote nauseating. I believe that because Lori on her own without Chad is quote unquote nauseating. Lori would get all dolled up before her video chats with her new husband, and Betty said that Lori seemed to want a lot of attention, affection, and reassurances from Chad that he loved her. And I get the feeling that Lori's one of those women who talk in baby voices to their partners. You know, like they try to sound like little girls for some reason. Kind of like Dahlia DiPolito. Link in the description box if you haven't seen that hot mess of a case. But do you know what Lori did not talk about while in jail with Betty? JJ and Tylee. They never came up once. And Betty said that she was convinced the kids were safe. Betty thought that Chad and Lori had dropped them off at some polygamy compound so that the new couple could start their lives together without baggage. I don't know how safe a polygamy compound would be for children, but okay, Betty. When Betty got out of jail, she texted Lori, and Lori, who was still in jail, texted back, "How are you doing? I've been praying for you. I'd love to visit with you. I'll schedule you in later today. Hopefully that will work." First of all, why is Lori able to text from jail? Second of all, she acts as if she's some like high-powered CEO and like the people who are working at the jail are her personal assistants. "Don't worry, Betty. I'll see if I can pencil you in today. Have your people call my people. But I only have 5 minutes because I really need to make sure that my pink lipstick is on point before my video call with my husband, Chad Daybell, who was chosen by God too, just like me." Did I ever tell you that, Betty? My husband? He's like the king of people that are chosen by God. And remember poor Charles Vallow, who screamed from the rooftops that something was really, really wrong with Lori, and no one listened to him, not even the police in Chandler, Arizona?
Find out what you need to do to prove yourself, because what it is committal paperwork.
Right.
They can hold you for 24, 40, however long they deem it necessary to get you evaluated.
Right.
Based off just what your husband
says. Says.
Yeah. So, doctors play it safe.
Sorry. I just think it's funny because he's trying to tell everyone.
Right. So,
that's very smart.
Because I'm really the one that did something wrong.
But, well, here's the thing. Is I don't know, and I'm not going to take sides.
Right. No,
but just talking to you, I mean, I don't see you being a danger to yourself or anybody else. You got your kids to school.
Right.
I don't know. But I'm not going to place that. I'm just going to let you know that we are required, if you're here, that we will, even against with fours, if we have to,
right.
If you're still here when it's approved, we'll have to take you to CBI.
Okay. And what is it called? I'm just going to write it
Community
down.
Bridges. Okay. If you want a free medical evaluation, psychological evaluation.
I haven't gotten any sleep in about 3 days. They have good facilities.
They do, actually, from what I understand.
A gym where I can work out.
Yeah, so
kind of happy.
Like I said,
you'll be okay without your mama.
You are going to get a padded room. Well, Fox 10 just did an interview with Lori's nephew. His name is Zach Cox, and Zach is the son of Lori's brother, Adam Cox. And Zach lived with Lori for, you know, specific periods, like months at a time in 2017, 2018, and 2019. So he had a front row seat to her unraveling.
Correct. Yep. I am Adam Cox's son, her brother.
So Charles Vallow was Uncle Charles to you.
Yep.
Tylee Ryan was like a sister.
Yep.
JJ Vallow was like your little brother.
Lori was like a second mom.
And I was, you lived with them.
I lived with them January 2018 to about May of 2018. And then I went back home for the summer and came back to Arizona September-ish of 2018 and lived with Lori until about January of 2019 when things really picked up and snapped off with Charles. It was 2017. They had just moved to Arizona from Hawaii. And I went out there with Colby and my dad for spring break. And they were all gone one day. Like everyone in the family went to do something or go see a movie. And I kind of hung out at the house with Lori. And she started talking about all these books that she's been reading. Chad Daybell books. I forgot what this other book was called, but it's really controversial in the LDS church for the beliefs. I'm trying to remember what it is. I'll say it if it pops up. And I'm talking about Julie Rose podcast and listening to those things. And she said some scary stuff that kind of, I was sitting there with JJ and one of my other cousins. And to me, I was, I think 17, 18, she was saying, you know, if you watch an R-rated movie or say a bad word, there's always an evil spirit that's screaming in your face, like encouraging it. And I was on my phone like, wow, that's crazy. So, you know, time goes on. I move in with them and start working in Arizona. And, she spent a lot of time at the temple. Charles would go on trips, so I'd help in with JJ for business. So I'd help watch JJ, hang out with Tylee. She'd be at the temple for about 8 hours a day, like a full-time job sometimes. And I think on Thursdays, she actually did work at the temple in Gilbert. So a lot of the changes I saw was she started to, like if we were driving in the car, instead of listening to the radio or music, it would be a Julie Rowe podcast. A lot of really religious outside of the church podcasts. So she was always listening to something from these beliefs. And change wise, because I had talked to Charles about it, because she was telling us that she never had to eat again, never had to go to the bathroom, that she was invincible. When she was saying these things, it was towards January of 2019 when she had kicked Charles out of the house. That's when I had left, and that's when she was saying those things mostly.
So Lori was spending a full ass workday at her temple every day, leaving little JJ to be raised by Zach and Tylee, and she was telling people that she never had to eat or go to the bathroom and that she was invincible. And I have to wonder, right? Did she just never eat around people? When she went into the bathroom, did she come out and tell people, like, don't worry, I wasn't peeing in there, all right? I just like to go in there and pray because it's quiet and private. I don't need to pee. I'm not like you, mere mortals. Zach said that Lori had been manipulative with him and the rest of their family when it came to Charles Vallow. She had told them that Charles was having an affair, and as a result, everyone in Lori's family immediately sided with her, took her side, and turned on Charles. By this time, Lori had already started talking a bunch of nonsense. Okay, so I think that her family should have realized that she was talking a bunch of nonsense, so maybe the whole thing about Charles being like a demon and having an affair might have been nonsense too, but not the Cox family. No, no. So Zach got the opportunity to talk to Charles about all this before Charles died, was murdered, before Charles was murdered by Alex Cox and Lori. and Chad. And Zach asked Charles, you know, like, what do you think's going on with Lori? Do you believe in the stuff that she's saying? And Charles told Zach, you know, I don't believe in this stuff, but it makes her happy. She's still, like, taking care of JJ. She's still cooking dinner. She's living normally, so apparently it's not, like, affecting her day-to-day. So if she can continue to believe these things that are making her happy and she's not hurting herself or anybody else, what's the harm? Which normally I completely agree with, by the way. Completely agree with that. Like, it's hard to even say that sentence ironically because I 100% agree with that. But in Lori's case, I feel like the things she was saying, like calling her husband and children demons, I just feel like that's kind of like past the line, you know, past the line of where you're not a threat to yourself or anyone else. Charles told Zach to just nod his head when she talked and keep her happy, which she was until she met Chad Daybell in October and he started sending her emails about dark and light spirits and past lives. Zach said to him, Chad Daybell was just an author whose books his Aunt Lori and his Uncle Alex loved to read. He didn't know at first that Lori and Alex were actually meeting with Chad. And Zach said that Alex had actually given him one of Chad's books and told him that if he read it, he would give him $100. Because Alex and Lori really believed that these stories and the people in the books were real, even though they were fictional books. And Alex is trying to convert. He's trying to convert Zach. They're trying to bring more people into their little culty fold.
Yeah,
Alex and Lori were both on the same wavelength with these books. They're always fans.
Yeah.
And wanted to bring you in or whoever would listen.
Right. Yeah. The thing about Alex too is mentally he was always off. Like, he was a weird guy. And he was definitely easy to manipulate. And I think Lori knew that. And she was very manipulative. But he full-hearted believed these things. She had told Al that she talked to Jesus Christ face-to-face one time, and Al went and told his bishop that. And then his bishop was kind of like, that's kind of strange. That's an awesome experience, but I've never heard of, you know, someone saying that before. And Lori had gotten mad at Al about it because Al would go and say these things to other people that sounded crazy, which were crazy. And she knew that, and it would upset her that he would go tell other people that. So that's how that really was. They had that dynamic of always, same thing with him, you know, he was a truck driver, and instead of like listening to music or, you know, the radio, he was listening to religious podcasts and these, I don't know what the right word is for these books, these preparing of people books, maybe.
Yeah.
Kind of about the end of times and things, but.
Yeah. So like I said, Lori and Alex, they're trying to recruit people. And we know they successfully recruited Lori's niece, Melanie, who up and divorced her husband after being married for several years, after having multiple children together. And she just married some guy she barely knew and then moved to Idaho. Zach's also suggesting that Alex was the follower here and that Lori was taking advantage of her brother, being well aware of how easy it was for her to do this, take advantage of him and manipulate him. See, she sounds perfectly competent to me. It's evil and it's calculated and she's kind of like a freaking mastermind, but perfectly competent. And then Zach said that Lori would get mad at Alex when he would tell people about all these things because she viewed them as outsiders, right? And she was basically running point on creating a cult with Chad. And we all know, when you're part of a cult, you're not supposed to talk about what goes on in the cult to anyone on the outside. It's like Fight Club. Zach talks about a fight between Lori and Charles that happened at the end of January 2019. It was January 31st. This was the fight that brought the police to Lori and Charles's home. And right after this, Lori told Zach that Charles was dead and there was a zombie living in him.
And I start packing up my things. And Tylee comes upstairs because Lori had asked for Tylee to go pick up JJ from school. So, and take him to do something fun. So Tylee had asked me if I wanted to go with her to pick him up from school and go do something fun. So I said, yes. So finish packing my things, load up my car. We take her car, go pick up JJ. And then we went to eat at Freddy's. He loved going to Freddy's right by his school. And then we went to the movies and we saw a movie and JJ loved to play in the play area at the movies. So he did that while we were watching a movie. And I came back and got in my car and I went to my grandparents And my whole thought process during this time was that I don't like conflict. I know Lori and Charles have had fights before. I know this one was a little different with why she was fighting with him. And I really, to be honest, I just didn't want to be involved. It was something that I thought they would work out, things like that. So it was a long day. I get to my grandparents around like 7:30 at night because they know Charles is having a fight. Charles and Lori were having a fight. And I said, hey, you know, can I stay with you guys for a little bit if that doesn't pan out? And they said, sure. And I regret it. I plugged in my phone, set it down, and I went to sleep that night. And that's when I woke up to 30 texts from Charles. That was the night that, and I should have called him. That's probably one of my biggest regrets is that I didn't call him that day driving to my grandparents saying Lori's going crazy. You know, he had canceled. Like that's one of my biggest regrets with this whole thing. And
so you have witnessed that she was upset. You're on that other side where Charles is coming back from Houston and you are with Lori and she's saying that he's a zombie, he's Ned or Nick Schneider. She cancels his flight, etc. The truck is taken. His stuff, I don't know, how does one person go about removing all these belongings too?
So she had Melanie Gibb come over and help her out. And that's when me, Tylee, and JJ were gone.
It was just her and Melanie Gibb
packed up
taking out all his clothes, his laptop, yeah, or whatever he had.
So Charles had said too, once he found his stuff, because I woke up to about 30 texts from him and I woke up at 7 and called him instantly. And he said he was at the house. And he found his stuff. She hid all of his stuff. She packed it up in boxes and put it behind the food storage in this closet because she had a ton of food storage too. So she left it all behind this stuff thinking he would never find it. Or it got to a point where she eventually told him where his truck was. And there were some other things that happened. I think he had gone to JJ's school that day too to pick him up with the rental car. And he took her purse and that was that whole thing.
That's a little body camera footage and Lori's telling her side to the cops and eventually she goes and gets mentally evaluated, but she's released like that.
Right. So yeah, if she can pass that, then she's fit for trial.
Yes. Yes, Zach. Yes. Thank you, King. If she can pass that, then she's fit for trial. Say it louder for the people in the back. Zach said that everyone in Lori's family just immediately believed what Lori was saying and just started hating Charles and then not answering his calls or his texts and sort of being really crazy, creepy, and culty when it came to anybody in the family wanting to still have a relationship with Charles, still talk to him and kind of get both sides of the story.
Who is everyone, first off, so people know who's everyone? The majority.
The whole Cox family. Barry, Janice, Summer, her husband, Colby, Kelsey, everyone took Lori's side immediately without listening to Charles.
They assume she's telling the truth. Yep. He's having an affair.
Yep.
We don't want anything to do with it. We're not talking to him.
My dad, me, Brandon was monitored by Melanie when it came to talking to Charles, because she was obviously really tight-knit with Lori. But we were the only ones talking to Charles. And I really felt like I was an undercover agent talking to Charles without, because if they saw his name pop up on my phone, I knew, you know, there'd be conflict, there would be a fight. So I would be texting Charles, call him when I was out on my own or driving around. And this went on for really that whole period up until he was killed, from about January to July.
When you say monitored, Melanie Pulaski monitored her ex-husband, Brandon Boudreaux. What do you mean, like checking the phone for Charles?
Not checking it, but like Brandon wouldn't be able to get away to actually like speak with Charles. He never really had the right opportunity. They had the kids they had to watch. Like he couldn't really get time to himself. So I remember one time too, Charles was saying that he's going to move back to Houston with JJ. And this was, Kay came down to visit Charles and stay with him. And he said they were moving. If I wanted to come by, because I would go by the house, see them for a little bit when I could. I was going to real estate school at the time. And after class, I'd go and see them and then head home. But he said one point they were moving back to Houston, which they did. And I told my grandparents that I was going to go see Charles and JJ before he left. Well, my grandma had texted Lori about that and said, hey, just a heads up, because I saw that she left this text, her phone on the computer. Not phone on the computer, sorry. She left her phone on the table in the kitchen, and it said, like, hey, Zach is going to see Charles and JJ, just wanted you to give you a heads up. Because at this point, I would text Lori occasionally to check in. I think this is when she was in Hawaii, kind of off and doing her own thing. This is when no one really knew where she was at.
Yeah.
And I was worried about her. I mean, this was a really confusing time for me, to where all this stuff is going on. You know, I know if I get caught talking to Charles, I could get kicked out of this house. I know that I love Lori and I was worried about her at the time. And I want to make everyone happy. Like, I don't want people to think I'm siding, which...
I'm sorry, but how did the entire Cox family believe what Lori said, to the point where they were taking part in this monitoring calls from Charles Vallow business? And Zach also talked about the day Charles died and how no one even told him or his father, or, you know, a good majority of the family that weren't, like, wrapped up in this crazy culty thing. Nobody told them that Alex had shot Charles. They had to find out on the news.
Another key thing that Charles said was that everything Lori is accusing Charles of doing, it's what she was actually doing. So she was accusing Charles of cheating with, you know, prostitutes, whoever had this girlfriend in Texas, when she's really having an affair with Chad Daybell. After Charles was killed, no one in the family told us. Colby, my grandparents, no one texted us. So my dad's in town in Arizona, and we're house sitting at my aunt Summer's house because their family's in New York, and we're watching their dog. And my dad flew in Wednesday night. Thursday comes, which is the morning that Charles was killed. And, you know, I go to work that day. My dad does whatever with my grandparents. I think he went to go eat with them and then was at the house. And then that night we went to play basketball. Friday comes, we went to see our second cousins that we were related with. Still no word from Charles. You know, we sent him a couple texts, and it was weird because he's normally always on his phone. So at this point, Charles has been dead for basically 24 hours, and we still don't know. No one told us, texted us. They all knew because they were going through Charles's phone and saw that me and my dad were texting with, and Brandon were texting with Charles, the family, the Cox family. Friday comes, we go visit with second cousins. I get off work, go to sleep that night, texted Colby if he wanted to go play basketball, no response. Obviously, we texted Al if he wanted to go to the comedy club to go do something, no response. So no one's responding to us, no one's talking to us. Saturday comes and we drive up to Tucson to see my dad's friend, to visit with him. And while we're driving up there, we were seriously like, did they do something to Charles? Because we haven't heard from him in 2 days. Calls, texts, and I mean, he was always on his phone. He would at least respond. So we get there and we start talking to my dad's friend in Tucson, and we're like, man, we haven't heard from Charles. Like, Lori and Al have been super crazy. And at this point, me and Lori have zero relationship. She had said some more rumors about me that she had spread to the family and to Melanie, Brandon's ex-wife. Because at this point, I was living with Brandon and Melanie. So I experienced the same thing with their marriage, you know, again. And it's just a mess. So
it's a lot.
He gets killed the 11th in the morning. It's July 13th, Saturday afternoon. We're in Tucson. And we're telling my dad's friend, like, we think Lori and Al might have done something, because it's just so weird that we haven't heard from him and how crazy they've been. And my dad's friend goes, well, how do you spell his name? I want to look him up, like, on social media or online to see what it looks like. So he Googles Charles Vallow, and all these news reports pop up. Texas man fatally shot and killed by brother-in-law. And when he said that, he read that out loud. And, like, I get goosebumps still talking about it, but, like, my heart dropped. And we pulled up the article, and, I mean, instantly reading it, saying that it was self-defense and Charles hit Al with a baseball bat. I mean, if Charles really hit Al with a baseball bat, Al would be dead. I mean, Al would be seriously injured, not able to shoot a gun. He wouldn't have one tiny scratch, you know, on the back of his head.
Yeah. He would be blacked out, knocked out at the least.
At least knocked out, right? Bleeding, needing to go to the hospital. He would. You know, Kay and Larry were on speakerphone. We were on speakerphone. And I was just sitting there with my shirt over my head, head down. I literally could not believe this had happened. Like, they murdered Charles. There's no doubt about it. So, and then, you know, when you see the footage of the body cam of the police, he's laying there with the bat perfectly next to him and his flip-flops are still on. I mean, if there was a scuffle, at least, like, to me, flip-flops are coming off if there's a scuffle. I mean, there's just so many things that stuck out to me when I saw that video that didn't add up. And the baseball was placed perfectly, didn't roll around. Like, it just, the bat, sorry, not the baseball, the baseball bat. It just didn't make sense. Off the rip, we didn't believe it. Lori at this point had told the family that my dad, me, Brandon, Charles were all conspiring against her, trying to get her insurance money, which is what she really was going after with Charles. Like he had said, everything she's doing is what she's accusing him of doing.
It's a great interview. Zach has a very interesting perspective. And if you want to watch the whole thing, I've linked it in the description box. I believe it's just over 30 minutes. All right. So in conclusion, Lori Vallow is perfectly fit to stand trial. The only thing she doesn't understand about the court proceedings is why they're even happening to begin with, because she thinks what she did was completely acceptable in God's eyes. Therefore, no court of man shall pass judgment on her, because she's such a narcissist and she's so full of herself that she thought all of this would buy her a get out of jail free ticket. All she had to do was slap some pink lipstick on it, right? And shoot out a little wink and a nod to the judge. I also believe that she thought she'd covered her tracks well enough so that she would never have to answer for what she had done. The fact that Lori and Chad made moves to cover this stuff up, buying burner phones, getting a storage unit, that completely shows you that she was in her absolute right mind then and still is. Because insane people who commit murders and crimes out of insanity, they don't have the foresight to even worry about getting caught. They're not thinking about getting caught. They're just being like compelled to do this by whatever's going on in their head. And they're not like, let me cover my tracks. Let me cover this up. Let me make sure I don't get caught because I know what I did was illegal. Now, in Idaho, those charged with a crime who are ruled unfit to stand trial will typically be held in a state-run mental hospital until the evaluators believe that they've regained competency, and then the trial will move forward. So the good news is she's not going to be found not guilty due to mental insanity. I don't think that's even a thing in Idaho. But it could be years or even decades before evaluators believe she's fit to stand trial, meaning the trial may never happen. Because if all Lori has to do is pretend to be confused and scared and unclear about what's going on in the trial to avoid being charged with these murders, she will do it. She already thinks she's walking around and living in a movie about her life, starring her, where everyone else are just peasants who haven't been touched by God. This would basically just be a different part for her to play, since she believes God's writing her story and he's just changing the script a little bit because he knows what she did was right, according to her. I'm not speaking for God. And he doesn't want to see her rot in jail for it. But I do. But I do. And you know what? I think I can speak for God when I say he probably does too. If you're up there, big guy, give us a sign. Do you think that Lori Vallow should spend the rest of her life in prison? Whoa, do you see that? The lights just went out. I think that's a yes. I think that's a yes, guys. So like I said, Lori Vallow is clearly bananas, but not everyone who's mentally ill is walking around in a gray cloud of confusion. She is and has been very lucid, very conniving, very calculating, and throughout this entire process, she's remained that way. And I'm sorry, but I don't feel bad for her, because there's plenty of mentally ill people who struggle on a daily basis. They struggle with things like BPD, schizophrenia. They don't kill their ex-husbands. They don't kill the wives of their new crushes. And they don't kill their children. I mean, yeah, some of them do, but a lot of them don't. And the ones that do, they can rot in prison too. I don't care. So in the end, what I'm trying to say is Lori Vallow had a choice, and I feel no sympathy. And I want her to sit in a cell filled with roaches for the rest of her life, not hanging out in a mental hospital, watching herself on television and telling the nurses that she's going to pray for them. Being mentally ill does not automatically mean that you are not responsible for what you did. It doesn't automatically mean that the things you did are not your fault. It certainly doesn't mean that you're a good person, right? So take, for example, these notorious villains who were clearly mentally disturbed. The Joker, John Kramer, aka Saw Dude, the Texas Chainsaw Massacre guy. We don't look at these people and feel pity for them. I mean, maybe you do, but I do not. And I know what you're gonna say, Stephanie, these are fictional characters. They don't really exist. I know that. Okay, then. What about David Berkowitz, son of Sam, who was diagnosed with schizophrenia, and after some back and forth about this mental illness, he was deemed fit to stand trial, as was Jeffrey Dahmer, who was diagnosed with borderline personality disorder, who was found guilty and sentenced to life in prison, as he should have been. The thing is, yes, they were mentally ill, but I'm sorry, who the hell cares when you're talking about a serial killer, when you're talking about a psychopath or a sociopath? Who the hell cares? Plenty of mentally ill people recognize that they have a problem. They realize that they're a threat to themselves and others, and they seek help because they're good people who don't want to hurt anyone. People like Lori Vallow, David Berkowitz, Dahmer, they did not seek help, and this could be for many reasons. But I believe one of those reasons might be that they didn't care if they hurt people. Okay, so that means they're not good people. And I can't save the world. I can't worry about every single person and their specific individual experiences. I'm curious about these things. I think it's interesting. It gives me some illumination into why. I might even feel pangs of sympathy sometimes for these people due to things they went through in their childhoods. But at the end of the day, it doesn't matter. Lori Vallow took multiple lives. She's tried to evade taking responsibility since day one. She's never expressed remorse, not only for her part in the actual murders, but just in general because these people are gone. She's never apologized to the people that she's hurt. She deserves to be in prison. She deserves to have a very hard life. She deserves to be miserable and have dry skin and no nice cellmate who's gonna give her lotion. She deserves to pay for the lives that she's taken with her own. And that's that. And like Zach said, if she was able to convince the police in Arizona that she was mentally competent, that there was nothing going on there, that Charles was just a big liar, she can clearly turn it on and off whenever she wants to. She's clearly been using this to manipulate people. It's so obvious that it hurts. But let me know what you think about all of this in the comment section. Thank you so much for being here. Don't forget to check out my podcast, Crime Weekly, that I co-host with Derek Levasseur, who's a retired police detective. New episodes come out every Friday, wherever you get your podcasts, but the episodes also go out on Wednesday on YouTube. Like this video if you liked it, share it if you think it's worth sharing, and don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already. And if you have already subscribed, make sure you still are subscribed because YouTube likes to unsubscribe people from my channel all the time. I don't know why. God told them to. Maybe it's part of a grand plan. Thank you guys so much for being here. Stay kind, stay beautiful, and I'll see you very soon. Straight down, and that river runs deep. The mountains get steep, and the voice is getting too loud. All these feelings I've buried is looking like a cemetery. They're coming back from the grave, calling out my name. Better say a Hail Mary. Well, you don't know how deep it goes until it's getting you slowly. And so you got to let it go. I got blood.